met Michael C. Vasquez was the first time I heard that Lotus, the Journal of Afro-Asian Writing, had been published out of Cairo. It was the summer of 2011. We were at a cafe called Downtown 34, sitting beside a wall of windows that looked out onto the fortified synagogue on Adli Street. To put it plainly, our talk was like a time warp. What I recall is being hurled into a universe in which the island of Cyprus, that said haven for hijackers, had transformed itself into a portal for an unpredicted past. Mike remembers more. We came to the same place with different magazines in our head that wore the same magazine, is how he puts it. What he means to say is that while he had known Lotus as a Cairo-based publication, I had thought it to be of Beirut. There was a reason why this was not trivial. His coherence complements my pause, which is that of dizziness. Mike was chronologically correct. The periodical did start off in Cairo and was edited out of here for a good 10 years. Initially titled Afro-Asian Writing, its inaugural edition ostensibly appeared in March 1968 in Arabic and English, and then later followed by the French. By its sixth issue, By its sixth issue, which came out in October 1970, the Trilingual Quarterly had acquired the name Lotus. The Afro-Asian Writers Association and its overarching affiliate, the Afro-Asian People's Solidarity Organizations, both had headquarters that hailed from this interface of Africa and Asia, the capital of Egypt. During those heydays, these institutions had been granted mansions that operate till date through some sort of leftover mandate in their names. As it turned out, Mike's position stood firmly on the floor. Then one day Lotus moved. It went from Cairo to Beirut. In the wake of Youssef el Sebai's death, the streets of Cairo swelled up in protest. On the 19th of February, 1978, as his body arrived from Cyprus to be wrapped up in a flag and ready for a state-sponsored service, the newspapers had spread rumor that the Palestinian Liberation Organization was responsible, and this in turn had spurred hate. The crowds were a frenzy as the procession took place. And ceremonious sorrow, with its customary incantation, "There is no God but God," gave way to more passionate and perverse political refrains. "No more Palestine, no more Palestine. Arafat, round up your dogs." Prime Minister Mustafa Riyadh stood up and declared, "No more Palestine after today." The bullet that had killed the Minister of Culture was seen as having hit all of Egypt. Aggrieved as he was, Anwar Sadat did not attend his dear friend's funeral and sent Vice President Hosni Mubarak to show face instead. Sadat was 6 months from secretly signing Camp David, and he had already gone across to talk peace at the Senate, which was, after all, why Sebai had been targeted in the first place. In the week that followed, a man was thrown off the metro by a mob gone mad. Children at school were harassed and attacked. The police went about a spate of unwarranted interrogations and arbitrary arrests. A shopkeeper turned up to work one morning to find that his store window had been smashed. Many have marked this as the moment when public opinion in Egypt swerved. For whatever pan-Arabism may or may not have meant, citizens were now incited to feel, 4 wars later, they had sacrificed too much of their bread in standing up against Israel, and the media took it upon itself to fuel the brazen anti-Palestinian sentiment that surged. On the 28th of February, the official daily Al-Ahram announced that the government would reassess the privilege granted to Palestinians as nationals in Egypt. And then later in the year, 2 decrees were put into effect, Administrative Regulations 47 and 48, to deny them rights they had thus far availed. In the summer that followed, the fault lines of a complex web of relations between Cyprus, Egypt, and the PLO got reorganized and reimposed. And on the sidelines of this was the undetermined future of a magazine called Lotus. It's hard to tell whether Youssef el Sebai's last editorial, which only appeared in print after he had passed away, was specifically intended for the thematic issue on Africa in which it was included, titled The Historical Cultural Task of the Afro-Asian Intelligentsia. It covered more or less the same ground as what he had produced for the launch of the decade prior. That one had been called The Role of Afro-Asian Literature and the National Liberation Movements. Marked for the months of April and September 1978, the posthumous volume was co-edited by South African writer Alex Laguma, who had probably stepped up from his position as Deputy Secretary General at the last minute. And it was this issue, number 36-37, that concluded Cairo's term. Darul Udaba was no longer the permanent bureau of the Afro-Asian Writers Association. When Mike mentioned his fascination with the assassination of Youssef el Sebai, I had a faint sensation that I'd heard this already, like I'd come across it elsewhere. But up until then, as far as my fixation with the magazine went, there was no reason for Lotus to have even been before Beirut. It was the idea of an Urdu poet moving to that city, which was soon to be sacked, that had been my hook. Clearly, I was there more as on a whim, asserting my own angle of incidence onto things, as if it were that of theirs. We were the only two customers in the cafe that morning, and had taken the liberty to request the waiters to turn off the disco pop, the one thing reminding us of the present. The high ceilings and the hardwood floors, the placement mats with images of long ago, had all probably contributed in some subconscious measure to the air of our exchange. And as we whirled our way into Cyprus, time curved around us from another direction. It was in fact as he sighted Cyprus that I had felt some sort of undefined awareness surface. What was this Egyptian guy called again? I imagined myself having asked. And while I can still hear Mike's voice in my head pronounce Youssef el Sebai, just as he always does, like a word I would never be able to spell, in that moment, the name itself had drawn a blank. In any case, it had felt far too early in the morning to be making notes, so I carried on listening and let the whole thing pass. All of which to say, I was sure I had no sense of Sebai, and thus no cause to dwell on my unlikely knowledge of this piece of the puzzle that was his demise. It was only over time, and on its own terms, as my research expanded, and I started to put more of it together, that I too found myself perplexed by the pivotal role his death had played in a certain unraveling of the not-so-non-aligned pan-Arab nexus. It was, after all, the event around which so much had turned. But a trace of that vague familiarity lingered somewhere in the back of things. Recently, this is actually in 2013, when I walked past the place that Mike and I had encountered each other's affinity for Lotus, I found that it was all boarded up. The cafe had been open a couple of years, and now it was soon to be as if it had never occurred. Soon after the Permanent Bureau of the Afro-Asian Writers Association in Cairo folded, a poet from Pakistan by the name of Faiz and Affairs arrived in Beirut to take over the chief editorship of Lotus. Both the man and the magazine had relocated from different places to be granted home and hospitality by the Union of Palestinian Writers, many of whose members were probably there as exiles themselves. Mahmoud Darwish may have been looking over the Arabic edition, and Yasser Arafat grew involved in some occasional advisory capacity as well. Curious then is this, why were the PLO so invested in Lotus, extending in-house resources to revive it? And what made Faiz leave Lahore at the age of 67 to set up base in the midst of it? Though the worst may not have happened yet, the Lebanese Civil War was well underway by then. The year was 1978. Well, that's bits of what I've published so far on my work and research on Lotus. And I just wanted to share a few things in terms of where this is going, and partly maybe, you know, where I've arrived at. Insofar as like the macro history of this magazine, I think what's quite perplexing is that even before it's published, there seems to be this tug of war insofar as this attempt to claim the Afro-Asian Writers Association and everything it stands for. So simultaneously a peculiar, faith in culture as something that is to be used, you know, in national liberation movements, and at the same, because the Afro-Asian Writers Association is kind of a subset of the Afro-Asian People Solidarity Organization, which was very much involved, kind of in political movements and political solidarity, basically. And so, even the fact that, you know, there was this pull between, like, China and to keep the Afro-Asian Writers Association under its kind of influence, even before it was producing anything. And then the way in which that continues to be the case, such that in 78, when it is no longer the, the Arab contingents on the board declare that, you know, it's not possible for Egypt to be responsible, and the editor had also been assassinated, that then the, you know, PLO kind of take it over, and while in exile, decide to give refuge to this editorial board in Beirut, which I think Salima has published some notes about her visit in 1980, which were really insightful. And so that's kind of one track that I've kind of arrived at. But the beginning of this project really was with a fascination to think that that Fez was in Beirut and, you know, during the years of the Civil War, and everything that I came across insofar as, this is pre-2011, so the material that, you know, has now surfaced had not as such come out then. And the stray things that I found were all convinced that Fez was melancholic during his time in Beirut because he was out of language. There is a small passage, so just a paragraph in Edward Said's Reflections on Exile, where he recounts his encounter with Fez in a bar in Hamra. Iqbal Ahmad is there translating. So Fez is reciting his poetry and probably over a drink, and Iqbal is translating, and at some point Iqbal stops translating, but Fez continues to recite, and it's a very beautiful night. And, you know, Said does this very quick thing in his text where he uses this encounter to, you know, talk about the difference between forced exile and self-exile, but also to conclude that Fez was melancholic because he was out of language. And I've been thinking a lot about what it means to be from a language rather than just a place. A few weeks before Fez passed away, he, I think, wrote to Agha Shahid Ali, or at least this is in Agha Shahid Ali's poem. So the line that I write, I think, goes, a few weeks before he died, Fez Ahmad Fez wrote from Lahore that after the siege of Beirut, he had no address. And I've been trying to think about that, you know, that claim, given that, okay, Fez, of course, despite the fact that Fez had studied, done a master's in Arabic as well, it didn't mean that you would converse in colloquial Arabic. But Arabic does draw from, I mean, Urdu does draw from Arabic, and what does it mean to kind of be from a language and then become from another place? But also what that means, I think, across a generation of poets, because when I was trying to trace this, there's a line in Agha Shahid Ali's poem, which is the title of this talk, called Mad Heart, Be Brave. And I'm going to, give me a second, I'm going to repeat the line. So it is as if by turn, in Amitabh Ghosh's eulogy to his Brooklyn buddy, Agha Shahid Ali, that I find my cue. Ghosh mentions at some point, in discussing the lyrical discipline and unabashed attitude of Ali's bardic register, that he knew no one who would even conceive of publishing a line like Mad Heart, Be Brave. That line, Mad Heart, Be Brave, when I first read it in The Country Without a Post Office, it struck me too. And I think I've come to think of it as being somehow symptomatic of what it means to be Urdu English. So to be from a language and then perhaps rendered in another. So I stopped there on that track. And of course, like getting when you, I mean, spending time with actually the editorials in Lotus is interesting because a major shift happens. What I was trying to get at with like showing the kind of similarity of Sabai's editorial is saying that this was really just, to me, potentially even an empty, like an empty form. And I think when Spares takes over the editorials, there's a marked shift in his thinking about the role of the intellectual in a post-colonial context. I think in one of his first editorials, he marks that difference by saying it's easier when you're not free to know what, as a writer, what you are writing for, and the risk is to slip into, to kind of become the intellectual elite when the liberation struggle is won. And he was also talking about decolonizing literature, and this is, I think, maybe in 1982, which is maybe around the same time that Salman Rushdie is writing Midnight's Children, which is conceived of as, having decolonized English. So I think the place where, just to try and make sense of why there's this macromancy in history and then this relationship to, a particular individual, and thinking through, through his relationship to language into maybe mine. Given the kind of mired state of our attempts to understand like Cold War politics, where there was still, these two, seemingly these two camps, but of course everyone, it was much more complicated. So the reason to go, to think through affairs and somehow come in response also to that. I'm not sure if that last point made any sense, but I'm gonna wrap up now.
You mentioned something about language, and there's somebody currently starting research on poetry, Fez's poetry in those last years. I, for myself, I'm going to make a totally intuitive sort of comment on Fez's last years. I think he found his last great love in Beirut, which was the Palestinian Revolution. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the poetry reflects this, all of the deprivation, the loneliness, as you said, not having, it was not really the language, it was the fact that when a poem came.
History of a movement that is like all radical movements seem is designated to have failed. Mm-hmm. Or failed at least in its most ideal aspects. It might have achieved small gains during the period, and you make that assassination as an enigma in a sense. It doesn't hold, historically it doesn't kind of, does not explain.
The debacle that Sadat caused, it's something that's actually very repressed even in Egyptian memory, that he actually like completely disregarded, politics in terms of like nation state protocol and just sent his commandos. It's a long story because once Sabai was assassinated, everyone who was Arab in the Afro-Asian People's Solidarity Organization meeting was held hostage and taken on a plane and driven all around. And so I'm just going to read one thing to address this generational element, and then I'll take on that question somehow. Sorry, give me a second. So I actually also didn't take you all through the building where this Common Bureau is, but I read a section of arriving upstairs. So The main room is flooded and bright, and the reality of the streets outside enters inadvertently, makes itself felt. On the wall across the doorway are two portraits and a nail. Kamal Abdel Nasser, Anwar Sadat, a suit, a uniform, and a conspicuously missing frame. This is 2012. At first I don't notice, but I am pointed to it with the raising of an eyebrow and a tilt of the head.